Good day, everybody. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on where you are in the world. Thank you very much for joining us today. We are going to start with some very quick overview of the accessibility features for today's webinar. So we are aiming to make this webinar as accessible and inclusive as possible. So we are going to be providing a very wide range of interpretation services. We are providing English live captions to activate the live subtitles. You need to click on the CC button that you see on the black bar at the bottom of the screen. If you are joining from a mobile phone, you might need to click on the three dots that you see at the bottom of the screen that says more, and then click on view full transcript, I believe. We are also providing international sign language. You will find the interpreter among the participants. The name is, I believe, SSL interpreter. Just remember to pin the video. This means that the video is going to remain displayed on your screen at all times. To do this, just click on the three dots that you find at the bottom, at the top corner of the video of the interpreter, and then select pin. We are also translating everything we say into Arabic, French, and Spanish. To access the interpretation, you need to click on the interpretation button that you also find at the bottom of the screen, next to the closed captioning button. Just click on the globe symbol and you will find a choice of English, French, Spanish, and Arabic. And there you can pick your preferred channel. Just keep it off if you'd like to hear the English. If you are having issues with interpretation, just please feel free to let us know in the chat. The chat is being monitored and we will try to help you as much as we can. Let's then move on to some housekeeping rules. It's very basic, but of course, you know that you should be muting your microphone when you're not speaking. If you have any question, you can raise your hand or just write in the chat. As I just mentioned, the chat is being monitored and we'll try to raise your question with the facilitator. After the webinar, we would really, really like you to fill in the evaluation form that you find at that link. We will remind you again at the end of the webinar. It's going to be really important for us to learn from you about how we did during this webinar and improve ourselves. This webinar is being recorded and we will make the recording and the presentation available at the link that you see on the screen. Thank you very much for joining. I really hope you enjoy the webinar today and good luck, everybody. I now leave the floor to our director, Balwan Singh, for a quick welcome message.
Thank you very much, Barbara. I'd like to wish all of you a good morning or a good afternoon or a good evening, depending on which part of the world you are calling in from. I am delighted to welcome you to this Sphere webinar on palliative care, which is part of an initiative on applying humanitarian standards to the global COVID-19 response. The aim is to build the capacity and understanding of humanitarian actors on relevant humanitarian standards for the COVID response. And this includes Sphere standards, the core humanitarian standard, and the standards within the humanitarian standards partnership. The webinar is the sixth in a series of seven webinars on humanitarian standards, and they present current and emerging guidance on humanitarian standards, including the guidance that was issued by Sphere in March of this year, which has been translated into a wide number of languages. The webinars also signpost participants to available resources and share good practice on community-led responses in particular. And these webinars are delivered in partnership with the CHS Alliance, the Humanitarian Standards Partnership, and a range of other partners as well. It gives me pleasure now to introduce my colleague Aninia Nadik, who will facilitate this webinar. Aninia joined Sphere in 2008, and she leads our policy and practice work in addition to coordinating the Humanitarian Standards Partnership. She was closely involved in the 2018 revision of the Sphere Handbook, and she has previously worked on internal displacement, refugee and asylum policy issues, and has a background in political science and international relations. Aninia, over to you.
Thank you, Balwant. Thank you very much and welcome everybody. I'll be your facilitator today. I hope everything will go great. I will start with just a couple of reflections around palliative care and humanitarian work and what we're going to do today. When in 2017, for the 2018 handbook, we included palliative care, we actually weren't sure if everybody would be happy about this, but so far we have not heard any critical voices, for which I'm really happy because it's important to include this important topic. It is essentially about values, and palliative care touches us all, whether we are humanitarians or not. And I think that the COVID-19 response and the impact of COVID-19 worldwide has actually made the importance of palliative care painfully clear, with many people, for example, having to die in isolation during the lockdown. And that is a very tangible example of where the right to die with dignity is not being fulfilled. And this is really our starting point today, to expand the right to live with dignity, which is anchored in the Sphere Handbook, to expand this right to live with dignity to include also the right to die with dignity, with all that entails. Today's discussion would be about why palliative care is important and what opportunities we have and obstacles we face to make it a reality, both in our societies and in humanitarian response. And I'm insisting on this because I think that when it comes to ethics and values, there should be no difference really between how we want to shape our societies and how we work as humanitarians. I will quickly go through the objectives today. First of all, simply to highlight the importance of palliative care for communities, for humanitarian response, and again, the right to live and die with dignity. Then we want to explore, as time allows, the palliative care standard in the Sphere Handbook and its relevance for Sphere's values and principles. We also want to talk about the challenges of integrating palliative care into humanitarian response, and also look at a few solutions that are easily that can be reached, and look at examples that come out of good examples of palliative care that come out of the panel discussion, and then also in discussion with you, the participants. The agenda is really straightforward. After a small poll exercise, which I hope you'll find quite amusing, we will go into a panel discussion with four panelists. And afterwards, we will have time for Q&A with the participants. And that is the broad layout, how we're going to organize this session. Now, I'm really, really happy about the panel we have today. We have four panelists, and I want to briefly introduce them to you, starting with Rachel Coughlin, who is currently affiliated with the Center for Humanitarian Leadership at Deakin University. She's a public health professional with 20 years experience in clinical practice and in international public health research, policy and advocacy. She worked for a number of international humanitarian and development organizations before she started a PhD at the Center for Humanitarian Leadership at Deakin University. And her research explores the place of palliative care in humanitarian emergencies and crises, with a focus on armed conflict settings. So really quite relevant for our discussion today. Rachel also works as a palliative care physiotherapist in Melbourne, and is member of various Australian palliative care research groups and networks, and now also focusing on COVID-19 and palliative care. And she is in Australia. It's really late for Rachel, so thank you very much for staying up for us. Our second panelist is Mona Lisa Matonda. She joins us from Zimbabwe. She's a clinical social worker at Island Hospice in Zimbabwe, and her work involves providing psychosocial support to patients and clients. This also includes trauma and bereavement counseling of individuals, groups, and families. She also trains health professionals, community home-based caregivers, medical students, allied health professionals, and others. Mona Lisa holds a Bachelor of Social Work from the University of Zimbabwe and has been trained in-house by Island Hospice in all aspects related to palliative care. Welcome, Mona Lisa. We also have Iba Pasha. Iba is the focal point and lead of the Global Health Cluster COVID-19 Task Team, and it is in this function that she joins this panel. She was also, I'm happy to say, one of the health chapter authors for the Current Sphere Handbook, so she knows the handbook very well. She's an emergency medicine doctor with over 15 years working in humanitarian health response with international NGOs and WHO. She also runs a local health NGO in flood-prone areas in rural Bangladesh. And so she's very much attuned with the constraints and challenges that smaller and local partners face, especially during disasters. And last but not least, we have Frances Tsikai on our panel. She also joins us from the Island Hospice in Zimbabwe. We're really happy to have both Frances and Mona Lisa. It's really a great knowledge that they bring to the panel. Frances is a palliative care nurse consultant. She has worked with Island Hospice for, I think, almost 30 years, and her work includes different models of care, which are home care, clinical care, roadside, rural outreach hospital visits, and office consultations. She also mentioned that they are currently integrating palliative care in the national health delivery system in Zimbabwe, which is very interesting. She holds a Bachelor of Science in Palliative Care, a Master's of Philosophy in Palliative Medicine, and a postgrad diploma also in palliative care medicine. So we have a really, really high quality panel that we can engage with today, and I'm really happy about that. The last thing I wanted to mention is back to housekeeping. At the end of this webinar, you will be asked to fill in an evaluation. Please do that. That helps us a lot to find out what worked, what didn't, and so forth. Now, the next step is we're going to, before we go into discussion, we're going to do a little game. We're going to do a little poll. So you will see, there you go. So this is, we'll have two polls all together. This is a little warm-up poll. You have the option to click on the region that that applies to you, where you are based around the world. And I'll give you a few moments to do that, and then click on submit. Go. And as soon as we have most polls in, my colleague Barbara will share the results. Shouldn't be much longer.
Anine, can you see the poll?
And I sent it.
Great.
Okay, let's see where people come from and where all around the world people have called in. Okay, so Europe wins. Well, we're also in the right time zone, to be honest. Everybody else is, it's tougher. Africa has quite a few participants, so has Asia, great. Middle East, Oceania is not so much. Central and South America, we have a few as well. North America and Middle East, as I said. That's great. That's a very broad, actually, representation of participants. Thank you for your interest, really, in this topic. We have a second poll, which is a bit more serious. And in that poll, we would like to ask what, in your opinion, the biggest challenges are for integrating palliative care into humanitarian work. And please note that you can choose more than one answer. So the questions, so the challenges that we propose are lack of understanding of palliative care, focus on saving lives instead of caring for the dying, lack of focus on psychosocial care, lack of funding for palliative care activities, lack of training on palliative care, lack of guidance on what it is, how it works, or other. Now, if you feel that there's an other that we haven't integrated here, please put it in the chat. And off we go. Thank you, Barbara, for sharing this poll. Lack of understanding of palliative care has carries the most weight, and followed by the lack of funding for palliative care and the lack of training, which probably all fall under the lack of understanding, because otherwise training and also funding would be more easily available. Lack of focus on psychosocial care is quite high up as well, which is interesting and which I hope we can get back to later today. The focus on saving lives remains an important challenge that we think palliative care is not part of that. And lack of guidance notes. And we have a few others. Notably, someone who said that it's important to integrate healthcare into medical work. So palliative care should be integrated into healthcare more generally, also into also the lack of community empowerment. So we're going to talk about communities later. I'm glad you mentioned this. We have fear of how palliative care will be perceived in different cultures. Thank you. The cultural aspects, we will hopefully get to that as well today. That's very important. Palliative care as extra work in addition to everything else. Oh, we also need to do palliative care. That's an important element of understanding what palliative care really means and its importance for human beings, for us all. Lack of understanding from a health program expert about the common barriers to setting up palliative care services, which are seen in any type of new palliative care services, not just in humanitarian setting. Okay. I think in general, this idea that palliative care is also important, and there's also these barriers are very similar to what we face in our own societies, is actually quite interesting. And then we have a last one that says lack of focus and understanding on how to integrate spiritual distress screening, history and assessment into palliative care, and how this is different from religious or pastoral care. Spiritual care is an essential domain of palliative care service provision. Okay, there are more. I cannot read them all out now. So I think, Barbara, do we have a third call, or maybe we should just keep going, because we had a third question about what do you think is included in palliative care? This is the poll we wanted to send you. And I suggest that we are not going to do that now, but let me read it out to you anyway. And I think the question here was, what do you consider part of palliative care? You can choose more than one answer. Physical care, spiritual care, psychological care, social care, or other. And we've seen now from the responses we got that indeed palliative care is much more than making sure that the whole physical care, physical pain treatment, it goes much further than that, and includes psychological, spiritual, and so forth aspects. Now, with that, let me move on to the next session, to the next element, which is the discussion with our four panelists. And I wanted to start asking each of you very, very briefly to tell us all how you approach palliative care in your work and what it means for you, very briefly. And let's start with Rachel.
Great, thank you, Ininia, and thank you, Despia, for having me in this discussion, and for what I think is my most technically complex webinar I've ever been on, certainly in COVID times. So congratulations to you for pulling all of this together. So as Ininia said, I'm a researcher at the Centre for Humanitarian Leadership at Deakin University in Melbourne, in Australia. And I'm currently researching palliative care in humanitarian emergencies and crises. I'm also a palliative care physiotherapist, and I work at an inpatient and a community-based palliative care service in Melbourne. And this year I've been on a national task force working specifically on COVID-19 and palliative care in Australia. So in answer to your question, I believe in the importance of holistic and compassionate palliative care for people with serious illness. And I think that the impacts of COVID-19 have really made stark to me the importance of this. While symptom control and physical care for people with terminal illness or with COVID-19 have, of course, remained essential, what we've all watched around the world are the impacts of prolonged COVID-19 restrictions, such as separation of families and patients, enforced isolation, and particularly the inability to be able to provide proper accompaniment and support in dying. So impacts on our normal social interactions and our normal grieving processes have become an increasing and significant source of distress for sick patients and their families. Certainly in my clinical work, I've lingered longer with some patients in recent months than what I might have done before, where they've needed someone just to chat to in their isolation. And have spent time at the bedside of dying patients to hold their hand when I've walked past and noticed that they're lying alone and separated from their loved ones. So I think that the COVID-19 experiences all around the world have highlighted the critical fact of illness, death and dying as much a social experience as a medical one. And even with the best medical care in the world, the absence of families and loved ones at the bedside of a patient because of visitor restrictions or because of enforced isolation has meant that there is still significant suffering. And in usual times, so much of the support that we might give a sick or a dying person is provided in informal settings, such as in the home or in the community where people live. And I think this is true in many communities who already experience humanitarian crisis, even before COVID-19.
Thank you, Rachel. I would like to ask the same question: how palliative care impacts your work, what it means for you, to Mona Lisa, very briefly. Thank you. Mona Lisa, you're muted.
Sorry about that. Thank you, Anemia. Palliative care for me means holding a patient or a client in distress hand, walking the journey together, and trying to make it better in whatever situation that they find themselves in.
Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, that's great. We'll get back to how you work on palliative care, what you do in your daily lives. Iba, what does palliative care mean to you, and how does it express itself in your work?
I mean, we all work in humanitarian crisis, and by definition, that means that we're in a situation where there is a higher rate of mortality and morbidity, so illness and death, compared to usual times. So by definition, we're all working in a situation where we should be thinking intentionally about death and dying and those who are ill and what they need. So I think for me, you know, just in general, just trying to ensure that we're going by ensuring that we're living and working to address health needs or needs throughout the life course in humanitarian situations is just a big part of it. I have personal experiences. I'm not a frontline provider right now, and it's wonderful to have the practitioners here who are really making the absolute difference to the patients, to those who really need it. But from my level, just in ensuring that we're really thinking about the life course of someone who's affected by whatever crisis it is. It may be COVID-19, it may be a flood, it may be an earthquake, but these situations come up again and again and again, and it's never not a part of the scenario. We all die, and we all have the right to die with dignity. And it's just wonderful that we as a community are taking this forward. Over.
Thank you, Eva. Thank you. Francis, how would you describe your connection with palliative care, knowing that it is a huge part of your work? But how's your connection with it? And you're muted. Francis?
Sorry about that. Thank you for the opportunity. For me,
I think you need to do something about your sound. Yeah, maybe use a microphone or so. I'll try again, but it's echoing.
Maybe I can call. Let me try again.
Okay, try. Okay, go ahead.
I was saying that to me, palliative care is a specialized approach where we work with the patient's family including children, in their journey through the illness, through all the illness. It means opening up channels of communication with patients and their family members. Sometimes you find that there will be a time when they are not talking about the illness, but with the presence of palliative care and the expertise, you open up those channels of communication, you talk about difficult topics and difficult issues. And also in this palliative care, when you're looking at end of life care, there is the need for preparing the patient and preparing the family for the eventuality of end of life. Can you hear me?
Yes, thank you, Francis. And that is very well stated. And I wanted to stay with you just one more second, because during our preparation call, you mentioned the term of total pain. And I'm really hoping that we are not, that the there are people among the participants who are discovering what palliative care is. And to me, that term of total pain was quite striking. And I wanted to invite you to just walk us through that, what that means.
Okay, what that means is that when you are caring for a patient and family, the family also experiences total pain. But in the family's total pain, there is no physical pain. Whereas for the patient can experience pain from physical pain, and they can also experience emotional pain. And this emotional pain comes about because of the fears that the patient will be experiencing because of the illness that they have. And the patient can also experience social pain. And social pain, it emanates from the losses, such as loss of body parts, loss of position, loss of employment. All those will cause the patient to have social pain. And the patient can also experience spiritual pain. And spiritual pain comes about when a patient is weighing up the significance of their lives. A sign that a person is going through spiritual pain is when you hear a patient asking why me questions. Why is it that this has happened to me? Usually, you know that it may be due to spiritual pain, but there is need for advanced communication or counseling with the patient. And at the same time, the family members can also experience social pain because of the losses that they were also thinking about caused by the loved one's sickness. They can also have emotional pain, and they can also have spiritual pain. And also on social pain, also sometimes the social pain can also come from the issues, from the lack of practical issues. For example, we are in a low resource setting situation where sometimes you can find that the breadwinner is the one who is not well, who's sick. And if the breadwinner is sick, it means that there is hunger in the house. So if there is hunger in the house, it also causes social pain. But managing that social pain, it needs practical assistance, where maybe the patient can be given food handouts, or maybe the children, there will be someone to pay school fees for the children. But for the patient, you will experience the total pain. And also on the spiritual pain, from our setting, you may find that in a family, there are people with different belief systems. So the patient can be believing something while the family members are believing something different, also causing mismatch, which causes pain.
Thank you. Thank you, Francis. That is very interesting. And what strikes me is that come to palliative care from that broader angle, the importance of it for humanitarian work seems quite striking, because if families need food, they need physical support to survive at times, and all those various elements of palliative care really are also part of humanitarian care, one might argue, no? And before we go again more into the humanitarian angle specifically, I wanted to go very, very briefly on a historical and cultural excursion, very brief, about where palliative care comes from and what it is as a concept and how it fits into our human history and maybe a European and quite, first of all, quite Anglo-Saxon culture, but then also into a global culture. And I wanted to ask Rachel to very briefly take us through that. Thank you.
Sure, thanks. So briefly, from a non-social scientist and non-anthropologist, so a whirlwind tour. So the central goals of palliative care actually did once feature strongly in broader society and in humanitarian response itself. So long before even the advent of specialist palliative care, all around the world, people accepted death and they accepted suffering from serious illness. So people died at home, families were usually intimately involved in preparations around a death and burial, and personal exposure to death was common. And it wasn't until early in the 20th century when mostly the Western world entered a long period in which death started to become taboo, and everything associated with death and dying was taboo. And so palliative care arose in part as a response to increasingly death-denying societies, if you like. And nowadays, certainly in Western cultures, families experience death a lot less often than they used to, and even when they do, professional services are brought in from the outside to support people with illness and to help them prepare and to bury the dead. And we've developed a consumerist approach to healthcare, and certainly in countries like mine, we now have a learned expectation that our lives can be sustained by intensive treatment and invasive treatment like intensive care units and ventilators. And this can be true, I think, now for health workers in many parts of the world, and even in the COVID-19 pandemic, the response or the conversation, even in existing humanitarian crises, has continued to really focus on, you know, things like how many expensive artificial ventilators a country has or we can make available in a country, how many intensive care beds can we quickly set up in a field hospital to treat people with the disease. And we often strive to keep people with severe illnesses alive rather than talking about how we might support those who are seriously ill and recognise the inevitability of death in a pandemic. And logical action means that we accept that death isn't a failure and that it's not an enemy to be fought and defeated at all costs. The formal humanitarian system owes a lot of credit to Henri Dunant's brutal yet really compassionate account of the Battle of Solferino in 1859, where he tried to relieve the suffering of wounded soldiers by accompanying and soothing the dying. And he proposed that relief societies should be established to assure more humane care of the wounded during warfare. And we know that his recommendations would later lead to the establishment of the International Red Cross and Red Crescent societies and the creation of the first Geneva Convention. So I think today, humanitarian agencies and actors at all levels need to remember their roots, where they came from, and that fundamental principle of humanity and its aim not just to save lives but to alleviate suffering. In humanitarian settings, we need to accept the limits of modern medicine and technology and come to an acceptance of death and the importance of compassionate care in any setting. Just to finish off, I think that we also shouldn't view palliative care necessarily as a shiny new intervention or innovation or just a new specialist discipline, but in a sense, is going back to the very roots of humanitarian ethos and ethics. And to work out ways to integrate palliative care into some of our existing ways of working. I think there's huge opportunities to integrate aspects of palliative care into the humanitarian sector's existing responses to mental health and psychosocial care, for example, and that's a really untapped area we haven't really explored yet. We also need to tap into the power of communities and what they have to teach us about voluntary caring for those who are suffering and dying, and what, you know, current ideas, cultural values and varied understandings of dignity, illness, death and dying can teach us. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel. That was a very comprehensive yet short. Well done. You mentioned the importance of cultures, of communities, of embedding palliative care into communities. And I wanted to ask Mona Lisa how you would see the place of death and of dying in the culture you work in Zimbabwe. And you mentioned before the difficulty, or I think Francis mentioned the difficulty to talk. No, you did. Never mind. The difficulty of talking about these things and dying with outsiders, and how you you then engage with people. Over to you, Mona Lisa. And you need to unmute yourself.
Thank you for the question. In our setting, most people traditionally have not been comfortable talking or discussing issues of death and dying. It's been considered as taboo. But as the world is evolving, people are coming out and discussing it, but not in large numbers. It's still kind of no-go area for most people. It's like if you're discussing death and dying openly, people would think, especially the relatives and the significant others, they might think you have given up on the patient. You're saying it's okay, they can die, they can live. But essentially, that's not the message. It's just that it's something that hasn't been practiced in our setting.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mona Lisa.
Okay, can I go ahead?
Oh, yeah, go ahead. Oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Yes. So then you find that sometimes the patient themselves, they are open to talk about that, and they want to discuss the deepest issues in their hearts. They can tell you something that they've never even shared with their relative or with their loved one, but they can talk to you about it when they are in their dying stage. So sometimes the family or the relatives might not feel comfortable with that. But because as palliative care practitioners, we have the skill to try and get the patient or the client to talk about their emotions and their feelings.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mona Lisa. I would like to move to Iba with my next question. And I would like us to try now and anchor palliative care in the sphere handbook. We know humanitarian work is about saving lives. We have relativized that quite a bit now because we brought in all sorts of other aspects of what it means to live and to die with dignity. Iba, how can you bring palliative care together with spheres philosophy, to rights, to people-centered approach, and so forth? You have a very clear, if I remember correctly, a very clear vision on how that those two elements fit together. Iba, over to you.
Thanks, Ininya. I mean, I think it's already there. It's clear within the Humanitarian Charter, for example. We talk about the right to life with dignity. So what does that mean? And it's really so wonderful in the handbook, because it's clarified, but you don't really find it in other documents or pieces of guidance. But it really articulates that, you know, having the right to life with dignity is really about values and respect of the individual, no matter who they are, what age they are, what gender they are, what language they speak, what group they are from, and what their life prognosis is. We don't talk about, oh, you have the right to life or right to and human rights just because you're healthy. We talk about very clearly in the Humanitarian Charter that it's for every single person. So if we're having that life course approach, if we're thinking about everyone in the community, then of course we are encompassing those who are at their end of life, or if they are suffering, and we should not prejudice against that. And that's very clear in the protection principles as well, is that we enhance people's safety and dignity and avoid them from further harm. We have to make sure the assistance is impartial and you're not discriminated. So you can't discriminate someone because you can't discriminate them from having services or care just because they're dying. We shouldn't be thinking like that, and it's clearly articulated in protection principles. And likewise, we talk about assisting people to recover from physical and psychological effects of the crisis. So throughout the handbook itself, whether or not you go to the health chapter and the palliative care standard, it's actually fundamentally rooted within the sphere handbook and the Humanitarian Charter. I mean, for sure, there has been a lens and a focus on life-saving assistance, and I think we're all guilty of that. But the fact that sphere has encompassed and really seen, okay, what are we doing about all these people who are in need at the end of life in situations where we know people are dying more than in normal situations? What should we be doing in those scenarios? And the beauty of the palliative care standard in health is that it encompasses all these things that we've talked about. It is a standard. It's a recognized standard, part of healthcare, according to WHO. Alongside curative care, preventive care, promotive care. So it's nothing actually new, but we've just defined it and taken it and said, actually, yes, this is our responsibility, and it completely fits in with what we've already defined as what we should be doing within the Humanitarian Charter.
Over. Thank you, Eva. Many thanks. I just wanted to add here that the core humanitarian standard is all about, you know, people-centered approach as well. And it also, in that sense, links directly with palliative care. And this is an important way of making sure that you don't forget the dignity aspect throughout the actual processes of running your organization. That's what the CHS focuses on in particular. And so all those elements fit together, as you just so aptly said, Eva. Many thanks. We need to move on a little bit. There's just too much to be talked about. I would like to briefly go into the cyclone EDI response with Mona Lisa. But before I do that, after Mona Lisa's intervention, I would like to open up to the chat and see if there have been questions. Manisha is monitoring the chat, so afterwards I will come to you, Manisha, for a couple of questions. If there are none, which I don't believe is the case, then we would move on with the discussion. Otherwise, we'll bring in some people from the floor. Mona Lisa, you talked a bit, Francis did too, but I have you now here for the... you were directly involved also in the response after the cyclone Idai hit Zimbabwe. And you mentioned a few challenges, but also good practices directly related to palliative care. And I wanted to ask if you could tell that to everybody, please, Annalisa.
Okay, thank you, Aninia. First of all, I said when there's a crisis, when there's a disaster or an emergency, you find that many times the focus or the priority is on physical care, on providing basic needs, you know, the shelter, the food, the medicines, and clothing. Very few people think about the emotional side of things, the psychosocial care. So when that is done, we then move in to say, okay, the person has got the basic needs. How about the emotional care? How about the psychological issues? So as Island Hospice and Healthcare, we responded to provide psychosocial care to some of those people that were affected. And we went in them to do some debrief sessions, trauma counseling, and bereavement counseling. Most of the people were failing to get that closure because what happened was they didn't see their loved one. All they knew was they've disappeared, whether they were washed away to our neighboring country, Mozambique, or whether they were somewhere under the water, nobody knew. But in the end, it was just a conclusion to say they have died. So you find that in that situation, you need to engage that person, talk about it, let them open up, tell you what they feel and what they think. But it's something that happens later when everything else has been attended to. And sometimes you find that it's the most important thing to talk about what's happening with them, what's going on, what are they feeling, what are the emotions. And so even after providing the basic needs, we still need to provide psychosocial care where we engage the persons affected to tell us what they are feeling, what's going on. And remember, Cyclone Idai was so, so traumatizing because it's something that happened unexpectedly. And somehow our nation was ill prepared for it. So people were just caught unaware. And you find that even when the burials were being done, people could not be buried like as a single person. They would be paired or there would be threes, fours in one grave. And sometimes they were even buried with somebody that they don't even know, with somebody that they're not even connected to. So that was a pain that caused emotional and psychological pain to their loved ones who experienced this whole issue.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. When you talk like that, then it actually sounds pretty clear that palliative care is an integral part of a population recovering from a stress that hit them. So really that it is part of physical and emotional recovery, isn't it?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you, Mona Lisa. Just to say that Mona Lisa also had talked about the fact that they did, I think both and Island Hospice in general do a lot of training of at community level, of social workers, of community leaders, spiritual leaders and also traditional doctors and so forth, healers. And we may not be able to go into more detail, although hopefully we will, if we get the right questions, which leads me to Manisha and Jonathan. And what are the questions that came in from the floor?
Thanks, Aninia. So we have a few questions, but I'd also encourage everyone to take a look at the chat because people have been posting links to a number of very relevant articles, as well as lots of praise for our speakers. So you can also save the chat later so that you can have those resources available. We've got one question from Pranabasu who asks, palliative care treats the person, not the disease, isn't it? to which Megan Doherty provided the WHO definition of palliative care in the chat, but maybe some of our speakers want to also come back on that question. And then Megan had two questions for you. The first one is, how can we support the further integration of palliative care into humanitarian responses? And the second, how do we ensure that the lessons and successes of various responses can be shared and the learning can be taken up by other organizations in other humanitarian settings? And that's all we have for now. Thanks, Nina.
Okay, thank you. Palliative care treats the person and not the illness. Who would like to answer that? I would very briefly, any comment to that question? Francis, maybe?
Palliative care is person-centered. Yeah. We provide individualized care to an individual, meaning that if a person has a diagnosis which is similar to the other person's diagnosis, they are treated as an individual. And we treat the person, not the disease, in the sense that when we are treating the person with the disease, we use the holistic approach that you talked about. We don't just concentrate on doing the operation and just talk about the operation, but you also look at how this disease has affected the person, how this disease is affecting the way they are functioning, and how they are, it's affecting their family members. So it's not about just the operation which has been done, but it's about the person as a human being and their family members.
Thank you. Thank you. The other two questions, I would like to pull them together. I think it's a similar issue. It's how can we support that palliative care is integrated into the medical system? And the other one, how can we share lessons and successes so that we can actually build up some learning? I would like to ask that question to Iba. It's about how do we make sure, what can we do instead of saying, oh, it's so difficult to integrate palliative care into our the world of our daily ways of working into medical world. What can we do? What are initial steps to go into that direction of integrating palliative care?
Initial, well, thanks, Aninia. Great question, and this is what we're all battling with or trying to work out. I mean, the first thing is to, as the speakers have said, is to acknowledge it, that it's a right. It's part of giving health care alongside preventive, promotive, curative, rehabilitative care, health care. It's a right that must be done. But also, and especially in humanitarian settings, we're significantly constrained for resources. So what's needed to provide wonderful, full palliative care, like with curative care or preventive care, we just don't have the resources, whether it's the personnel, we don't have the money, we don't have the medicines, we don't have the social workers, we don't have the systems. In general, we're always facing resource constraints. And that, unfortunately, is just the reality of a humanitarian context. We're always vying for resources and, you know, we just don't have the right things to address it. So the question is, what can you do that's useful and impactful, that's low cost, and that's easy for most people to provide? Is there any point in trying to alleviate pain with opioids, for example? Morphine, it's one of the standard medicines that's used for distress, for pain. But if we can't get that in humanitarian settings, of which we know we can't get, it's impossible. Just the procurement of it there's so many barriers to that. What can we do instead? So it's really about having that whole picture. There are small things like psychological first aid, and that's brought up in the sphere mental health standard and in MHPSS guidance in general, but providing the first simple step. And there are tools on this, on how to do psychological first aid in humanitarian settings. And it doesn't have to be a specialist carer. You don't have to be an oncologist. You don't have to be a specialist in non-communicable diseases or dialysis or anything like that. These are really for frontline workers with lower capacities or lower technical capacities without the specialization. So it's really about building up that workforce to do that. Simple tips and conversations on, you know, how to do an advanced care plan. You know, some questions, and there are some prompting questions you can have. How do you feel about this? Who do you want to be here with you right now? Other simple things within the COVID-19 with the COVID-19 situation and setting scenario is the fact that people aren't allowed to be with their families. The risk of transmission is high when you don't have enough masks or PPE. How can you give that family support? How can you allow families to be next to that person through their end of life moments? And there are other ways of doing it. ICRC, I remember, for Haiti after the earthquake, but lots of situations, use a phone. The humanitarian responders can actually give their phone for patients to connect and talk to separated families who aren't allowed in. You know, there's some simple tips that we need to, tips and tools that we need to be providing to our frontline workers to ensure just that simple things can actually possibly help in these situations. So demystifying it and simplifying it and giving the quick impact sort of interventions or tools is really what people are crying out for in humanitarian situations. We did a survey with humanitarian partners just quickly about what are the technical barriers or challenges, operational challenges that people are finding in COVID response. And a lot of it is really that they don't have the right job aids, the right tools. There's a lot of global level guidance, but the simple job aid or to help them do the right thing in situations just isn't there. So really simplifying tools for partners, for frontline workers, I think is a first step.
Okay. Thank you, Eva. This sort of fits with a question we got from Mila Petrova, who asked what would really be the three things to do to raise the profile of palliative care in humanitarian contexts. I think we've started to touch that issue. There's so much more to be done. There's also a question from Northern Uganda, where Moira Long works with South Sudanese refugees, and says, so where do we start? What do we do? And it's the same. It's this idea of starting with what we can, but we all recognize, I think, that especially funding and broader recognition of the importance of palliative care is really crucial if you want to do meaningful work on palliative care. And I wanted to bring in one person. I think you're online, Dr. Tasneem Azad, who works for IOM. She is based in Cox's Bazar in one of the refugee camps there, and she coordinates the IOM palliative care program there. And I wanted to ask you, Dr. Tasneem, to just give us, I hope you're out there, to unmute your microphone and to just give us a really short reflection about what you've heard here today and how that fits with your daily experience as a palliative care coordinator in one of the most challenging environments, humanitarian environments out there currently. Over to you. Thank you. Let's see. There you are. We cannot hear you, although you're unmuted. I can see that. Tavlin, I'll get back to you. We cannot hear you. Are there any other questions that people have asked?
Aminia, Rachel has some answers for you already, but there was the question, those three things. And then there's Moira Long who asks, our work in Northern Uganda with South Sudanese refugees emphasizes the scale of unmet holistic need. You're nodding your head. Did you already read that and I missed it? Or are you just nodding your head?
Very, very briefly, in a cursory way, I mentioned it. Yeah.
Then I'll skip through those. But there was a question about what indicators can we use to assess needs and outcomes of interventions? How do we ensure quality indicators? And in response, Unni Krishnan wrote, integration, in addition to what Eva and speakers have said, it's necessary to take up training, not just for doctors, but also for health workers, nurses, et cetera, and about mainstreaming palliative care in other disciplines, such as with teachers and family members. And that's something that's been tried at the community level in this South Indian state of Kerala. But no other questions from that.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Manisha. I want to pick up on the indicators. I didn't think we would want to talk about those today, but actually, for example, at Island Hospice, do you have indicators? To what extent is your palliative care work structured? And could we learn something from the way that you approach palliative care? That would be, I guess, for Francis.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. We train palliative care from health. We train health professionals, students, as well as the community caregivers. And we have also extended our training to the traditional healers and the faith healers. So some of the indicators that we use are to know how many people we have trained, the targets that we have you achieved, and to check whether they now know about maybe pain and symptom management, pain management, which tools are they going to use for managing pain, and also tools that they use for managing, for assessing and managing other symptoms. And for health professionals, we also train them on breaking bad news. It's very, very important to train them on breaking bad news and end of life care and the referral system, so that all the patients are not left along the continuum of care. Like, we train from the village health worker level and from the clinics so that they know about the referral system. And we are also aware that the population that we serve, most of the people that we serve, they also use their health delivery, health seeking behavior. Some of them also consult traditional healers. Some of them consult faith healers. So we also felt that those traditional healers and the faith healers need to be trained in palliative care so that they will know when to refer. They will also know about the issues of universal precautions. They will also know about communication, especially one of the principles of communication, which is the principle of confidentiality. And when we conduct the trainings, we do the community mobilization, where we involve with the community leaders, because we feel that if we could involve the community leaders, we are going to get buy-in from the community leaders and support from the community leaders, which will enhance and improve the referral system for the palliative care service. Though our main challenge is that of lack of resources, because sometimes you can have a patient who has been referred, but because they don't have bus fare to go to the other level, they don't go.
Thank you, Francis. Thank you very much. Also, in terms of learning and what we can, what options we have, I wanted to come back to, we haven't talked so much about COVID-19 today, but clearly COVID-19 greatly makes our lives more difficult and also our interventions. And, the Sphere Handbook obviously doesn't talk about COVID-19. We didn't know it would ever exist, but there is quite a bit of learning around Ebola in the handbook. And I wanted to ask Rachel whether you had mentioned in our talk, in our discussion earlier the other day, supportive care techniques that we could learn from the Ebola response. And I wondered if you could elaborate a bit on that and maybe any other easily applicable aspects that we learned from Ebola for palliative care.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think some of them have already been mentioned in the discussion in the chat. I mean, I think what the current pandemic is doing is providing an opportunity really for putting palliative care on the agenda in humanitarian contexts. You know, we've seen it thrust into the spotlight in really hard hit countries in the Western world. And, you know, there's been examples of where, I'm just thinking there was a World Health Organization document from Spain talking about how palliative care health workers had been redirected to provide critical life-saving care in when Spain was at the peak of their first wave, I think, and taken away from their palliative care jobs. So I think there's a huge opportunity, even if we don't have all the answers yet, of how to integrate palliative care into humanitarian settings. The occasion that COVID-19 does offer us immediately is a time for any humanitarian actor on the ground to share those stories and to bear witness to the suffering that they're seeing, and to listen and to capture and to document those stories of suffering and stories of caring for patients and for future efforts. In the way that was done during Ebola, I think particularly the West Africa Ebola crisis really highlighted the essential role of community-based models of care in delivering supportive care for very sick or dying people. Things like, and some of these have been mentioned, training non-specialists, training lay health workers or community health workers in basic palliative care, shifting resources into communities and tapping into existing volunteer networks, particularly around supporting psychosocial and bereavement care. I think there's also a critical role for communities, and this was highlighted in Ebola, in guiding supportive care in pandemic response with their unique understandings of what is culturally appropriate in a particular setting, what are culturally appropriate rituals on illness, death and dying. And until we do that, we need to recognise that, you know, that there will be a plurality in the way that we integrate palliative care across different settings. There's not going to be a one size fits all, and we can't assume that Western, you know, models of care that have been predominantly developed in the Western world will work in every context. I mean, one stark example from Ebola was when, you know, the delivery of black body bags to bury the dead in Liberia did little to garner community support for the Ebola response in a culture where white is the traditional colour of mourning. So some of these solutions need to be built by local communities themselves. And I think Eba already mentioned you know, the importance of innovations to enable patients and families to maintain connection, whether they're low-tech innovations like, you know, wearing a laminated photo of yourself on your gown to replace the smiles, you know, and the person lost behind the mask, through to higher tech initiatives like phones or tablets to maintain that connection. And I think there's a real need to open up the debate and to have a really open and honest conversation amongst humanitarian organisations from, you know, the strategic level, the policy level, right through to people working on the ground to, you know, in the context of a pandemic, to really find that balance, which is so, so difficult and so ethically complex, between how to deliver compassionate care and how to support people as much as we would like to versus tough public health strategies around quarantining and isolation and visitor restrictions. I think we're not quite there with really opening up the discussion yet. To me, that's okay. A critical in getting to tell us three things. Sorry.
Thank you, because we do need to move on. And what you just said really ties up with what Uni just sent. He says the current crisis should serve as a catalyst to drive policy formulation. There are some great grassroots and community initiatives. We have one on our panel today. And it is time to give a policy framework both for governments and humanitarian agencies. And to just say that Zimbabwe seems to be on the road to do exactly that. So that's a really good example probably to follow. And for this to happen, says Uni, in aid agencies, Sphere and other interested actors may have to champion the cause among CEOs and decision makers in aid agencies. I am extremely conscious of time. We have had more questions, and I'm really sorry that we do need to start slowly wrapping up the discussion. One thing I wanted to do before we close was I wanted to actually look at what the Sphere Standard on Palliative Care says, and whether through this discussion, which really just touches upon all those issues, and we would have needed another hour or two to really go into details, whether it really is apt to respond to all the issues we've come up with today. Standard itself, and I don't know if Roma can put it up, but the standard reads, people have access to palliative and end-of-life care that relieves pain and suffering, that maximizes the comfort, dignity, and quality of life of patients, and provides support for family members. And the key actions to this standard talk about, justement, integrating palliative care into all levels of the health system. The actions talk about developing guidelines and policies, about care plans, about triage guidelines, very important, and also focus on referral systems and community-based work and training of healthcare workers, having essential medicines available. There we go back to funding probably. And again, the importance of working at local levels, including home-based care. The indicators cover the availability of medication, training staff, and measuring the ability to provide palliative care to all those who need it. And the guidance notes, in addition to developing all those elements further, talk about the importance of helping the families, which we've talked about today as well, and social and spiritual support. So I think that broadly speaking, the palliative care standard as it is in the handbook does a good job at covering what we have discussed today. And I would hope that that it would serve us, as Uni says, you know, to as a tool to really promote and advocate for the importance of palliative care. And now, we can move on to the next slide. No, don't yet. No, let's leave it. No, go back to that. No, thank you. Because at this point, before we really wrap up, I would like to thank our four panelists, and I would like to give each of you literally 1 minute, not more, to, if you would like to say something about how this experience was for you, some last thoughts about from each of you. And may I stick with the sequence, Rachel, Mona Lisa, Eva, and then Francis, very, very briefly. Many thanks.
Thanks, Aninia. It's very hard to be brief. I'm not very good at it with such a rich discussion. But I think it's clear from the chat that there's a lot of interest in the topic and passion in the topic. And we now just need to work out how to harness that energy. But I think the starting point is opening up the conversation. And I think we could easily use COVID-19 as an opportunity to really get palliative care firmly on the agenda. I think we need to start small. I think we need to work out what tools do we already have that we can best utilise to work out how to integrate the most basic elements of palliative care in and build from there. Stop.
Thank you, Rachel. Mona Lisa.
Thank you, Ananya. Just to wrap up, I just want to say palliative care is an approach that we can practice anywhere in the world, be it in the village, be it in the urban setting, and we don't have to start a new thing. We can build from what we already have and integrate from there. So it's not like we're looking to start to reinvent the wheel. We have the wheel, but we just have to chop it up and add what makes it workable within whatever we have. Thank you.
Thank you. So just pump it up. That's a really important message. Thank you very much, Mona Lisa. Eva.
Hi, okay, great. I am going to plug some work and ask anyone who is interested to be involved in this. As Aninia is aware, with the Global Health Cluster Task Team, looking at COVID-19 response, we're looking at many things. One of them is ethics, but one of them, which I think this is really linked to, is defining what services should be provided during COVID-19. Whether it's COVID-19 or not, one of the things that we've realized is there's no clear way of determining what we should do or not. There's risk analysis, risk matrix, just looking at health needs. But when it comes to the vulnerable or populations at risk, including those who are dying, who don't signify big numbers, how do we ensure that they're receiving appropriate and relevant health care, which includes palliative care? So just to say, we've been developing this guidance note on how to prioritize services, but we're also going through a process of trying to, and this is brutal and scary, and the conversation is big, but really just trying to list the minimum red line lists of services that you just cannot not think about in humanitarian situations. And we're inviting key people from relative programs, whether it's maternal healthcare, whether it's GBV services, whether it's communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, but palliative care is definitely something that needs to be addressed. So if people want to be involved in that process, please do email me. And we'll be looking at it in the next couple of months. Ooh.
Thank you, Eva. Huge thanks. I wanted to come to your work as well. We didn't have the time. please email Eba, and if you cannot find Eba's email address, email the Sphere office and we'll put you in contact. Francis, a few seconds please from you, and then we really need to wrap up.
Thank you very much. This was my first experience in the webinar, and I would like to thank you all for the support that you gave me. Otherwise, my ending words are that palliative care, being a human right, is applicable or should be applicable in all settings. We should not also forget, of course, we are talking about people with COVID-19, and we are also talking about people who are incarcerated. All those special populations, they also deserve palliative care. So I am hoping that there will be availability of medications and resources to make sure that the palliative care is being provided everywhere, since it's a human right. Thank you.
Thank you, Francis. Thank you all for those beautiful words. That's a wonderful way to end this webinar. My thanks again to all of you, to you four. My thanks to the audience. Our huge thanks to the translators who did, I can't even think of what you guys did. I think it went to Spanish and then from there to Arabic and French. I don't know, it was an amazing setup that Barbara did with all of you, also sign language and captioning and so forth. A huge thanks for your continued support to our webinars in this important way to really make sure the webinar is inclusive. I would like to repeat that please fill in the evaluation form. It really helps us understand what worked, what didn't. You can find the recording and the presentations online soon. And I wanted to draw your attention to the last webinar of this series, Humanitarian Standards Matter. That's a pretty straightforward title, I have to say. It is, it's going to take place next Tuesday afternoon, Geneva time. You will find all the information in the events calendar of the Sphere website. And with this, my last words of thanks go to all the Sphere team and Manisha and Jonathan, who have supported this webinar in the last 90 minutes to make sure it runs smoothly. And that's it. And thanks to all you who have listened and have sent in comments, which shows us that the topic is of interest to you. And please let's stay in touch. Tell us more, write to us, and we can try to do something really good about this and take the topic forward. Thank you. And have a good day and good evening. Rachel, good night. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for joining. Let me also thank the amazing accessibility.